don't police my expressions.
Hello, everyone.
Hello. Welcome to Unpoliced
Expressions.
This is our very, very first episode. Yeah, and we figured that, you know, we needed to give you guys...
It's time.
Yeah,
it's time for us to have these conversations.
Yeah.
Give the people what they want. Bye. Anyway, I'm Naledi Chira.
And I'm Nyigolo Bokhamshikwambani.
And we'll be talking about dating while feminist.
Yeah.
For the first episode. You can join us in a conversation on Twitter, on Facebook.
Follow the hashtag.
And police expressions. Follow us on Twitter.
Please do leave your comments and subscribe to our channel on the red button below for more content.
Yes,
this will be a regular thing. So dating while feminist, we believe, is an extreme sport. Because we have so many expectations of ourselves, you know,
and also and the of our partners,
yeah,
of the societies we live in. You know, like, aho jole bi, la holy feminist, because there's so many things that you have to resist and rebel against.
Mm.
And at the same time, you know, you're not living in a microcosm world. Would imagine because you're dating and you're feminist, it means everything around you is now automatically fixed. You know, there's still those tiny things that we struggle with, like, who's gonna pay the bill,
right? Like, they think about first date and as a feminist.
Yes.
It's like, okay. You know, you could be running broke. Your bank account
broke
could be at like 21 rand.
60 rand that.
And you're going on a date as a feminist. But you'll still insist, right? On either paying the bill or paying for your half of the bill. Because you want to make this impression, you know,
that
to
you've
your partner.
Things going on for, like, you're your own person and you belong to yourself and your bills belong to you.
Yes.
And you're handling things. But, you know, that's the tricky part for me. I remember this one time. Like, since I got 60 rand, I'm saying 60 rand because it's from actual experience.
Mm.
I had 60 rand left, and I suggested the date. And we went for the wine date, and the bill was like 55 rand. I'll catch it. Because also, you don't want to come off as this broke person who wants to build with someone, especially if you're dating a rich man, or like with someone who's well accomplished.
Yeah.
That just sets different dynamics and tones.
You don't want to come off like you're dependent.
Yes.
Or like you're going to be dependent on this person.
They expect you not to be dependent on them because you're
because
feminist.
You're a feminist, right? You're a strong woman, right? You're independent, right? And then let's also speak about the psychological manipulation, particularly of cisgendered men.
Yeah, they come for you. They come for
you against you in
ways.
A relationship, right? They'll say things like, no, Marawena was... You're a strong woman.
You're a strong woman! And those are the things that we're also trying to fight as feminists, so we are not being seen as human beings that actually function like the rest of us, like the rest of the people. You know, Kuru must be this rock that can handle absolutely anything, you know, that can handle emotional, lack of emotional labor from the other person, you know, and it's meant to seem like it's okay.
Yeah, but
you know, you don't need me to be there. You know,
exactly.
Like, that person is just here physically, but they are distant in other ways.
Ways, because you're a feminist, right?
Yes.
I was in this relationship, which I recently got out of, with this guy. You know, that time I'm having issues, and you know, this is my partner. I can't even run to my partner to say, hey, babe, kopa untuse ke patele this thing, ekikolotang, or whatever, you know? But they're out there playing moreki with their friends and their friends' girlfriends and their other female friends. No, come through, come buy us drinks or come buy us lunch, take me out for lunch. And this person will gladly go and spend their disposable money taking other people out, being the patriarch for someone else, being the patriarch for their female friends.
Because they don't denounce their patriarchy just because you're a feminist.
Exactly.
The patriarchy continues.
Yeah.
Like, they're going to patriarchy throughout. But I think what bothers me the most is the gaslighting, you know, the subtle psychological abuse to make you question your values and your principles. But you're a feminist, you should be able to go through this shit, you know, because you don't need me to pull through for you or whatever. And also, they will eat at your self-confidence, like your self-esteem. You stop questioning yourself. Am I really this person? You know, because the relationship is heteronormative in most, well, in my case, that's the that's where we're at.
Mm.
And umuntu akhona uzodila ngawe psychologically and, you know, break your confidence to pieces.
Mm.
To pieces for them, obviously, to practice their patriarchy in peace.
Mm.
You know, that for me stands out a lot. And I still experience it.
I feel like anyway where the gender roles, like, sort of fall in line or sort of like, how do I say this? Anyway where the gender roles emulate this heteronormative gendered roles, that space is there, right, for psychological manipulation, etc., etc. Mm. Because how do we negotiate our positionality as feminists in relationships, right? So the idea that, say, you'll be expected to cook, if you're cohabitating or whatever, or even if you're not cohabitating, right, but like food then becomes your responsibility. Have you ever seen a hungry male, right, tell you that they're hungry?
And you're like, and then what must happen? And Marna was sitting there at the same time.
Exactly.
And you know, you are actually a domesticated person, and you like cooking all those things. But also, if feminism is
you realize the social, you know, like the social gendering, to be like something clicks in you, and you know, okay, it's your responsibility.
Mm.
You have to get up and feed this person, otherwise they're gonna eat you up. You know, it's like, actually, let me go make this person food. And my thing is, that's fine. That's all and well if you're happy and you're willing to do that, right? But then, like, when it becomes an expectation, right? I don't feel like women should make food if they don't want to make food, for example. Ne? If night is about to
cook, I'm food.
Let's not, right? Let's get take out or away. Na pay. I can put ya boroto le botoro with the two slime. Can you follow me? Richer sharp, you know, rubber sharp. But like, the idea that then one slowly becomes your responsibility, right? It slowly becomes what you are going to do in the relationship from this point onwards. When the prior negotiation was that, look, you know, these are my political beliefs about gender roles, etc., etc., let everything be a negotiation. But once we hit a high one, we hit a high two.
And I think also there's also that thing with Ungati, they want to conquer us, you know, and tame us. Ungati, we don't know what we are saying or doing when we say we are feminists. You know, it's like, no, let's test how feminist you are. You know, like, as I'm so taking bath, or let's make, like the example you're giving about making food, you know, and it just keeps growing and growing, and then you must end up questioning your feminism in the relationship. It almost feels like you have to denounce the feminism to keep the relationship going. At some point, it even stops. You know, you have to be an activist in your relationship.
Hey, yeah. Have you ever performed activist aerobics? Where it's like you're dating someone, but now you have to be an activist in your relationship. And this completely makes sense. Like, if feminism is going to be active anyway, I mean, it's about the realm of
personal spaces.
Exactly. It's going to be within the realm of intimate relationship.
True.
You know?
And then there's sex. How do you feel about the sex part? Feminist thing in the relationship in regards to sex.
I mean, it's hard, you know, because I'm just like, how much do I say, how much do I not say? Like, do we have to, see, for me, that there are specific types of men who shouldn't be dating feminist women at all.
Yes.
Like, firstly.
Yes.
Like, if I'm going to have to beg you and ask you to go down on me, for example.
Yeah.
No.
We have a problem.
Stay away from feminists.
Stay away.
Don't date them.
It's a full on give and take.
Leave them alone.
Yeah. In that is that, like, for me, I was usually the receiver of the pleasure, you know, and not necessarily the giver. Like, I don't do the most, you know. I don't do the, like, I mean, I don't work hard, you know what I mean. And now in a feminist sexual relationship, there has to be like a 50-50 kind of thing that's happening, where you give as much as you take. You
of
get
course.
What I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, also protesting the fact that it's always coming to you, it's always happening to you, you don't know what to say, what to do, but at the same time, you still have to give in into the sexual participation of both you and the person. Mm-hmm. That was my conflict. Mm-hmm. Until I decided, no, I'm going to take my orgasm.
Yeah.
Like, om you know, mu ya ta tele orgasm ya.
Yeah.
Just don't finish before I finish.
Yeah. No, I mean, is there such a thing as feminist sex? Like,
I think there is.
And what does that look like, yeah, right? I mean, what does it look like? Like,
I think it looks like
feminist
sex. You know, the sex is for you.
Heterosexual sex, right? We're being specific here.
Yeah.
Shoo.
The sex is for you too.
No, of course.
Hey, because, I mean, before I was feminist, the sex was not for me. It was, you know... And I think that's the case for many women. That's why you get cases where women dry up their vaginas. Mm. You see that story on Twitter. It was done by Dr. Cindy Van Zyl. That women dry up their vaginas because the men feel it's more pleasurable. But it's actually not pleasurable for the woman because when your vaginas dry, you
Which man likes dry vaginas? Guys, do you know anybody who likes a dry vagina during...
So if a man is me again, I get lapo.
What's a dry vagina during 6 months? I don't understand how that's pleasurable for anybody.
Mm. So that's I don't know why. Like,
don't they like vaginas?
Somebody said the struggle makes it more pleasurable.
That sounds rapey.
I was like, ding 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 ding. No.
Rapey.
The struggle makes it.
What struggle?
No. Why should there be a struggle?
Why are you having sex like this?
This is our pleasure. So now I'm never going to get feminism. She means no. It can't have... But how does feminist sex look like?
Sure. You know? I think it's a give and take.
Mm-hmm.
I think it has to be about reciprocation. You know? I think it has to be about pleasure. I think it has to be about consent, firstly.
Yes.
I think feminist sex is about consent.
It's about consent.
And it's about caring about consent, right? At any given point in time, consent needs to be negotiated. Now, I'm not saying that, like... Every time you change a position, now you and your partner must have a discussion about is this consent? Are you okay with me doing this? Whatever. I mean,
but I can take that. Are you okay with me doing
this? Yeah, you know. But like, I mean, no one wants to hear. Are you okay with me doing this 12 times?
Like 5 in the eye.
No, I mean, and also there's other ways to give consent. There's consent in body language. Yes. There's consent in gesture. There's consent in intention. There's consent in a lot of things. I don't think consent is like a bow your head now.
Yeah.
Something. And I mean, at some point we take this argument and we're pushing it into extremes now because I know there's an app that's being developed. It's called a consensual sex app. Okay? I forgot what the name of it is.
I don't know that
app. Yeah, actually. So like it's like an app where like before you have sex with your person, you sign a digital contract. To say that you have you want all the help in the world. Now you have to resort to digital technology.
It's toxic consent. That deep.
Isn't that bad?
That we have to sign.
How is consent such a difficult thing? How is consent such a difficult thing that now? No, but you know what it's about. It's about legalities and you know someone saying you know the whole like rape and whatever and this so basically they want evidence to produce for umpile digital consent to on this app
it's a good app.
I don't know, like how many of you guys are gonna sign digital contracts
before? I mean, I think that's because we have different kinds of sex. That's also another reason, you know. Okay. And talking about feminist sex, the reasons why you have the sex are your reasons, and you can own up to them fully. I want to have sex for money, I want to have sex for pleasure, I want to have sex to make a baby, I want to have sex for this and this. So I think agency in that part falls into what feminist sex looks like. You decide what encapsulates the sex. For pleasure, I want to have sex to make a baby, I want to have sex for this and this. So I think agency in that part falls into what feminist sex looks like. You decide what encapsulates the sex. You know, you own up to the sex, and it's not just something that you give out. And even if you give out, it must something that comes from you, I want to give the sex. You know, instead of it being put on paper, sex is because two people are together, or people are married, or people, you know? So
I don't know. I just think if we need a digital contract to actually understand what consent looks like, then we're not making any advancements. We're not making any progress.
At least it starts up the conversation that consent is mandatory.
Consent, yes, is mandatory. Fine. I get
and
it.
People struggle with understanding what consent is because they think that many things feed into what consent could be. Like the fact that say ajola, it means they're consenting to a sexual relation.
I mean, is it a feminist agenda to not have the whole world sign a digital contract before they have sex so that we have a clear understanding of... Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, hey,
you know, it's like...
It could be a shield. Like, I think it's a shield.
Imagine now, all of a sudden, we're at a date. It's nice. Khumunandi, raja dijo.
That's Khumunganjena.
You know, Sidama grapes, Khumunandi. And it's like, this goes to my place. It's like, actually, just log on to the consent app quickly. Mm. You know,
but I think it's good in terms of Uti, then you can drive the conversation on what you're consenting to. You understand? Like with instead of someone just assuming because I got you drinks, then you consented to sex.
Mm.
You understand what I mean? Mm. So then we can have that conversation, Uti. And also I feel like it's not progressive because consent can end at any moment.
Exactly.
You know, just because so I agree give consent in the now
and or at the end of our day, exactly.
What happens then? Because now I've signed, but I can still change my mind and say, no, let's stop. Actually,
that's I don't know. Maybe actually,
yeah,
we'll do more like research into this app and
we'll
find
definitely
out
come back.
And come
yeah,
back
I think it's something we should definitely look into.
Maybe they've thought around the stuff, you know.
Yeah.
But like speaking about dating Muslim, let's speak about social media apps. Let's speak about Tinder. Mm. Let's speak about you know, these like relationship apps, whatever.
Yeah.
Apps. Cause I mean the things that happen on Tinder. Happy Tinder.
I had Tinder. Like
how was your Tinder experience?
I got Tinder because of you. No,
my Tinder was great. I met with somebody I met on Tinder.
Whoa, like, you didn't tell me that part.
Yeah, I met on Tinder.
Yeah. Oh, my Tinder experiences were that lit. We to my farm, I saw someone kid. No, I think my Tinder was more active when I was in New York. Like, I don't know why. In Joburg and Pretoria, it's just like, okay, it's really like 3 matches a day or something like that. But in New York, like every day, every hour, and I want a bash, bro. Like, it won't look moose, man. But I think my problem, I don't know, it wasn't a problem really, but something that I can mention, worth mentioning, is how, you know, it's just on the basis of aesthetics, which feeds in into objectification, which is something that
That's
I, as a feminist,
true.
Don't agree with.
I mean, and let's be honest, right? Like, are you going to swipe right to a guy who's standing in front of...
in front of my head.
I don't know. Like, I'm going to give a terrible, terrible, terrible example.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be problematic, but...
I'm police!
Don't police my expressions! So say this guy is standing in front of a geezy, maybe like a vegetable stall somewhere in Mostrate, you know? Or some guy ending like on a cliff somewhere in Peru. Yeah,
Peru?
So yes, so do you swipe left or do you swipe right, right? Like Tinder makes you choose. Like, it shows you who you are and what you want, right? Like, do you swipe right and skip all the white people?
I don't.
Or do you, like, read up on their bios? Or do you,
I read.
Which kind of white people also?
Yes.
Do you swipe right to all the Indians? You know? Like, what do you... Do you only look at, you know, the profile of black men? Like, you know? And if it is... What kind
Somebody
of
once said that Tinder's like where interracial relationships
flourish.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But it's also like you can see someone's social status on Tinder.
On Tinder, definitely.
You know? Like
mine, I don't think you can see because it's very artsy. Like it's just a photo of me jumping up.
And yeah.
We're not greeny.
Yeah.
But for
a guy,
man,
you know,
that's something else.
People perform. Like, I'm totally turned off by men who pose in front of their cars.
Yes.
Ooh, it's not attractive.
No.
It's not sexy. No. Okay, nice. But
and then what? What must can happen?
You know? Make a
or so you drive motor yakho or kanjani like getting. And for me, I think it just screams low self-esteem.
Yeah. But traveling, I'm very turned on by traveling.
Yes.
You know?
So, you know.
So if someone is like into extreme sports, into like bungee jumping, into
I like suits. Okay. I like suits so much. I'm going to suit and power. I think that's also another thing that we're not too honest about. Like, you know, we like proximity to power.
Yeah.
Social power, economic power. You know, power is appealing, power is attractive. Well, for me at least. You know, so anything that's wavering along those lines, I find attractive.
But then how does your feminism get involved, you know, with your Tinder relationships? It's like, because there are people that you start a conversation with on these social media platforms and they are like off the bat ready to negotiate sex.
Yeah.
Right? They just like wanna fuck.
They do that.
No, you know? And then there's some, I haven't gone on many Tinder dates, I think I've only been on two, but it's like, you know, I have people who have stories. I know people with tons of stories about their Tinder experience. Zwelong Kore. These people are messy, they expect sex the moment they bite you, you know, they put you drinks, etc., etc., etc. So it's like, dating with feminists is a tricky thing.
Yes, because you understand the politics of sex.
You know, you understand the politics of money, you understand the politics of work. And maternity
and patriarchy.
And what work is valued, and how it's valued, you know, and you spend a lot of your life trying not to bite your tongue on any given topic. But when you're trying to negotiate a relationship, particularly with someone who's male, right, and patriarchal,
who thinks feminism is denouncing femininity.
Yes, who thinks feminism is denouncing femininity, denouncing the vulnerability of the traditional woman, you know? And while trying to negotiate a relationship with someone like that, you still find moments where you still have to bite your tongue. You know?
Yeah.
Okay, but like, let us know, guys. Like,
let us know what you think. How is it dating being a feminist?
You know, when you say men are trash, does your babe say, how, baby?
What about me? Are you talking about me? Oh, they do that! They do that! They do that! But someone just wants to run on me if you think men are trash.
If you think men are trash, as if the only man you engage with in the whole world is your partner. Come on, brother.
And also, they are trashy. They have trashy moments, you know. Like, hey, it's tricky, this thing. It's very tricky. Like, we have to have this conversation. So that's why you guys must join us. Let us know what you think. And we'll do follow-ups. You can get us on Twitter. You can get us on Facebook. Sikona. Let's get talking.
Don't police my expressions.
Okay, we should do that again. We can edit that one out.
No. Don't police my expressions.